would like to welcome Mr. Disamaya Yaki, secretary at the Sri Lankan Embassy in Sweden. Welcome. So we now turn to the next speaker here, Professor Surinder Jodhka, and who is actually at the moment a visiting professor here through the ICCR, Indian Council for Cultural Relations, and we are very happy for that and grateful to ICCR for sponsoring this. We have had Professor Surinder Jodhka here since last fall, and he will be here only for 2 months more. We will try to keep you here. You don't know that, but I have actually stolen your passport, so. So, Professor Jodhka is a professor of sociology and also chair for the Center for the Study of Social Systems, School of Social Sciences at JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University in New Delhi. He has also a lot of other appointments and distinctions, such as advisor at the Indian Council of Social Sciences Research at New Delhi. He's also the director of Educational Records Research Unit at JNU. He has been an honorary fellow at the Indian School of Political Economy, Pune, and director of the Institute of Dalit Studies from 2008 to 2010. His areas of specializations are political sociology, social and cultural identities in contemporary India, social stratification, rural society, and agrarian change. He has a long list of publications. His most recent books are Caste, A Short Introduction, published by the Oxford University Press this year, I believe?
Last year.
And then another book, Village Society, Culture, Politics and Social Life in Rural India, published by Orient Blackstone last year also. And Changing Caste, Mobility, Ideology, Identity, he's the editor of that book, and it was also published in 2012. So I don't know where you get your time from. Absolutely amazing, I think. Okay, so now we look forward to listening to you and your lecture on the Indian middle classes, number, games, and social change. Please.
Thank you very much, Anna. Thank you very much, Lund University, for having me here. And it's really been a very wonderful time here. I'm going to be very, very simple and straightforward, talking about numbers, and I'm talking about middle class, something which, in a sense, all of us are. Indian middle class is obviously also Indian. And that is what I would like to kind of program, how do we talk about the Indian-ness of the Indian middle class, where does it come from, and where does the middle classness of some people become middle classness. Almost all over the world, Indian middle class is being talked about in different ways. Recently there was a news item in the New York Times about Indian middle class rising politically, protesting against rape. Before that, we heard about the anti-corruption movement, which was not only led by middle class, but it was also a middle class movement. Within India also, we've been talking about this middle class India, which has, in a sense, emerged in the last 20, 25 years, and which is very different from what it used to be earlier. We rarely talk about rural India, for example, now. That is not where India lives, as Gandhi had talked about. Even when urban India is less than one third of the Indian total population. So how does one think about this urban or Indian middle class, not necessarily urban? There's a context to it, and that is what the latest report of UNDP talks about, the rise of the South. You have Then we talk about tribes of the South, we talk about China and India. And when we think of China, we think of manufacturing, we think of laptops, we think of all kinds of manufacturing, almost everything that you buy from toys to computers in Novaland supermarkets, you will have made in China stamp on it, except for big buses which are made here, Volvo car, buses and cars. But small manufacturing is all done in China. You don't find those stamps made in India, Indian garments. But we think about Indians, we think about software engineers, we think about technology, we think about this kind of human capital. So in a sense, the way new world is being talked about over the last 20, 30 years, there is a difference between the way China is represented as center of manufacturing, production, and the way India is represented, which is the place where you have these smart young people who move around all over the world, have virtually captured Silicon Valley through their mental skills or whatever. So there is expansion of civil service sector in India, and that's where, in a sense, even quantitatively speaking, the impetus to India's growth come from. There's also been a lot of criticism of middle class, Indian middle class in India, as well as in academia, apart from Indians, other people who work on middle class. Last week there was a report in the newspapers all over the world that one third of the most poor in the world, chronically poor, this was World Bank report, live in India, one third of all poor in the world. So how does one talk about it? If you look at statistics, if you look at data, more than 50% of Indians would be described as poor or near poor. Government of India would admit 30% plus people live below the poverty line, that is virtually the starvation line, 30% Indians. So nearly 60% Indians, some estimates would suggest, are deprived in some way or the other. Amartya Sen calculates deprivation level of malnutrition children. So it's very large. So India, this wonder, this is also a land of contradictions. These are all realities. Indian middle class is visible. I belong to that kind of category. Many Indians sitting here belong to that category. And they are all over the world. You can see Indians almost in every known university in the world and in good positions. So you have these kind of realities of India, which in a sense become very contradictory. So that's what I'm trying to, in a sense, understand through this short presentation. Conceptually speaking, middle class is seen as a category of the model. It's not something that exists always. It's not something between rich and poor. People like Karl Marx or Max Weber or other classical theorists, as we call them, Western scholars, they talked about middle class when capitalism began to develop. Initially, Marx, as most of you know, thought of middle classes as people who were going to disappear, people who were part of, in a sense, capitalist economy, but not really exploited by the capital and not had become capital. So eventually, either you become capitalist or you become working class or proletariat. Later on, he also thought about new kind of middle classes, which would be ideological classes, which could survive, but they would also, in a sense, become some kind of wage laborers of the corporate sector or something like that. Max Weber, who, in a sense, also conceptualizes middle class as a category of the modern at some level, he talks about the new skills, people who earn their living through skills. They are not owner of capital. But they are not wage laborers, so they are not the ones who have nothing but chains to lose. So you have this conceptual history, but if you look at the history of Indian middle class, that's also seen as being very modern. It's not something which one would talk about in time of Akbar or in ancient times. So middle class did not exist. There were people in the middle income category, they would have been very poor people, they would have been rulers and the ruling classes, and there would have been people who were helping them, assisting them, who were Babu bureaucrats even in the medieval times, as we call them, or during Mughal kind of court. But they are not described as middle classes for whatever reasons. So sociologically speaking, middle class is a category of the bottom, category that emerges along with the development of market economy, capitalism, etc., etc. When you have this new kind of class system emerging. So having that in the background, there are specific historical trajectories in which middle classes develop. So there is no one single universal middle class, even working class people would say, or the bourgeoisie. There are specific historical trajectories within which these things develop. In case of India, we have, one can think of middle class in terms of three moments of middle class. I think the first moment of middle class is the moment of birth, in a sense. And it is born during the colonial period, when the British colonial rulers begin to develop India, so to speak, begin to develop modern India. They introduce railways, they introduce modern factories, but they also introduce a new administrative system. In order to run that, they need human beings, and Britain didn't have so many human beings that they could manage a country as vast as India. So they started a modern education system. And modern here basically means English language, quote unquote, secular education system, and that in a sense also created a new class of people who started working in the British Empire, and they were educated. They were not the ones who were poor. They were not the ones who depended on land. They were not the ones who were very rich. So they had to work, but they were not poor. They were ones who kind of had some kind of privilege. And there is a history, a social history of this middle class who comes into this education. A large number of people also go as far as Oxford and Cambridge and London and study there, and then go back and become barristers at law and senior civil servants. So they acquire a lot of distinction. So if you see this history of 100 years, say late 19th century or mid 19th century, early 19th century to the early 20th century, you have a large number of people in absolute size. In relative terms, they would not constitute more than 1 or 2% of India's population. But there were a large number of people who could be described as the new class of babus, as we call them, small clerks, petty clerks in the British Empire, but also a kind of upper middle class, people like Nehru, people who eventually formed Indian National Congress and they led India's movement for independence. Even Gandhi and Ambedkar would constitute that. So you have, in a sense, a middle class consciousness emerging in India during the freedom movement. And these people saw themselves as middle class, as being different from the local, class of rentiers or people who owned land, people who were very rich, who were with the British or against the British. But these people were different. Somebody like Nehru or somebody like Ambedkar, somebody like other people who participated in this nationalist movement, they studied abroad, they had skills, and they came back, they had a kind of vision. And in a sense, Nehru articulated what being middle class means. And I read this text from this essay by Raka Ray. To be middle class was to inhabit a particular orientation towards modernity. It meant being open-minded and egalitarian, following the rule of law and not being swayed by private motive or particularistic agenda, and being fiscally prudent and living with one's own means. Embracing science and rationality in the public sphere, it demanded setting aside the primordial loyalty of caste and kinship and opening oneself to new affinities and associations based on merit and to identities forged in the workplace. This is classical. If you read somebody like Imail Durkheim, when he's talking about division of labor, it would sound more or less the same way. So modern society is society of individuals who come together, associate with each other because they share the workspace, not because they share a kinship community. So it is with this kind of modernist agenda that you have somebody like Nehru becoming the first Prime Minister of India, and that's when the second movement of middle class starts. And that's critical, I think. That phase is very, very critical, because after independence, the qualitative different phase. One is that India is an independent country, its ruling classes or the rulers, ruling elite, are themselves all Indians. And the other thing is that for the first time, India begins a process of what is called as development, along with development, is also a process of state formation. And I think the state formation and development together produces a large middle class in total numbers. If you look at the expansion, which I'll show you in a short while, from 1947 or 50-51 to 1980s, there's a massive expansion of the state sector. And this expansion is also ideologically led by this middle class. So there's a nation-building middle class. These people see themselves as people who are building a nation. They have an orientation. They would talk about scientific temper, not that they did not have contradictions. They look at West as the model. We were talking about this universal model, that India, there's a linear path to progress and eventually we will reach there. Even though they have their own primordial identities, in many ways they continue to be very conservative, in many ways they continue to be very religious, they continue to be very, very, very traditional. They also were a privileged class. So on the name of nation building, most of them, even during the colonial period and the nation building period, they came from more or less socially homogeneous background. They were all, mostly, almost all, were upper caste. It's a fire alarm. most of them were, they came from upper caste background, Hindus largely, but not only Hindus, they were also people who were Muslims, they were also Sikhs who were part of the middle class, they were also Christians. But there is some kind of caste power which in a sense is asserted. So there is a kind of patriarchal authority, almost all of them are men. So be middle class during the Nehruvian period was to be a man who would work with Jawaharlal Nehru, build institutions, somebody like V.P.R.V. Rao or C.T. Kurien, they set up institutions and they were very committed. They were very loyal to the way nation was being built. You also have somebody like B.R. Ambedkar, after independence, who becomes the first law minister, who comes from an untouchable family, who struggles hard to find space in the larger middle class space and fails in a sense. If you look at the biography of Ambedkar, he failed miserably. He did his PhD from Colombo and from LSE, and then he comes back and he's not able to find a house in the town of Baroda. And then he goes to Bombay and sets up his own kind of political formation and starts a movement mobilizing Dalits and tries to kind of find space for this new upwardly mobile Dalit lower middle class, if you can say, very small in number, but looking for space in the urban modern context and finding it very hard. It doesn't happen. And that's my formulation. Though it happens in the sense that the foundation is laid after independence when quotas are introduced, 1931, when you have Poona Peck. But then after independence, when Government of India adopts a new constitution, there are quotas for scheduled castes, ex-untouchable communities, and scheduled tribes. And that is a very critical moment. But you don't have a Dalit middle class at that time. You don't have Ambedkar being visible or being talked about. So this is a kind of largely upper caste, traditionally privileged set of people who are professionals, educated, largely urban, who become middle class, become system, part of the state system, but also some independent professionals, doctors, lawyers, and stuff like that. The number is there, they're significant, they're very, very influential, very, very powerful. They are, to some extent, role model, but they share power with other interests, particularly the landed interests. Rural interests are still very powerful. India is still land of rural rich. The rural rich, in a sense, begins to control the state level, local level politics after democracy is institutionalized. But this class becomes significant as a class of civil servants, etc., etc. The real middle class revolution occurs in 1990s in India, if I can use that term. And that's when a major expansion happens. And that is the period of liberalization, as we call it, or neoliberal kind of policies, when India opens up to the world. The world also changes after Cold War. You have this new global market emerging for new kind of services where India seems to be kind of benefiting a lot. Before I start this story about the third movement of Indian middle class, let's look at the numbers, because numbers are very, very important. And last 10, 15 years, we have been talking about these numbers, and there are many different kinds of numbers. And they are, I'm not really making a quantitative argument. My argument is very different, but it kind of, in a sense, is very important to look at these numbers. Why is India talked about? Because India is one country which has had positive growth rate all through, and since the 1990s, it has been growing at 5% plus. Right? If you look at the 8th plan onwards, the growth rate from average 3 to 4, it goes up to 6, 7, 8, 9. Up to 2011, the economic growth in India has been 8% plus. Even last 2 years when the world has been in recession, if you look at the last column, the world has been in recession, India continues to grow at 5 to 6%, and now the predictions are it can go up to 7% again. So there has been no stagnation, there has been no moment where there was no growth. As I said, India is the land of contradictions, and it continues to be a land of contradictions, and there are major contradictions. If you look at the sectoral division, still agriculture or primary sector employs largest proportion of the working population, 56% in 2007-08. It would still be around 55%. Secondary sector, which is industry, etc., employs only around 19% of the working population. And then tertiary sector, which is the servicing sector has expanded and has been growing consistently, something like 25% plus. Poverty, we already talked about, everybody agrees, these are Government of India figures, that even in 2009-10, you have 32% of people living below the poverty line. So something very, very basic. These are not just poor, but people who are in desperate situation. This is the story I was telling you about the Nehruvian period, how employment grows in the organized sector. That's where the foundation is laid for the new middle class. And these are people who get into the government sector, public sector. Many of those who are software engineers in private sector, their parents would have been employed at various levels in the public sector. So in 1956, you have only 5.23 million people working in the public sector, the government sector. By 1980, the number goes up to around 15.5 million. And then you also have private sector beginning to grow. So absolute numbers are quite large. One person, one household, you can say that, you know, this would work out to be, if you have 25 million people, almost 100 million middle class households, 100 million people or 25 million middle class households, which is not very large, but if you look at comparatively, it is not insignificant. These are the people who are getting a regular salary. They are the people who mostly live in urban areas. They are the people who have a pension. They are the people who are also given a house by the government. So as I told you, in the last 5 to 10 years, there has been a lot of quantitative or statistical discourse on middle class, how to calculate middle class. And most of this discourse has been dominated by statisticians, demographers, economists, and they're basically looking at income categories. And the purpose of studying middle class is basically to measure consumer kind of population or consumption capacity of a country. This is a very well-respected kind of estimate, National Council of Applied Economic Research, which does huge surveys. According to them, nearly 52% of Indians can be seen as deprived, nowhere near the middle class. Then you have another 34% who aspire to be part of the middle class. They already, their children are studying, or they are themselves looking for a job. But they're large numbers. This is 34% of India's population, which is very, very large. People who can be called properly middle class, they would only be around 13%. The 13% also would work out to be something like 130 million, which is larger than the largest country of Europe. But there are other estimates, which Asian Development Bank, for example, looks at middle class or Indian middle class in a more disaggregated way.
that you have these three categories, people who are rich, middle class, in the sense that they are still middle class, they earn salaries and stuff like that, or they are middle class, and then there are lower middle classes, people who are in kind of, who are consumers, but who cannot buy a car, but they can buy a scooter, or they can buy a motor bike, or would have television, would have other amenities, etc., etc. So if you put them together, it comes to around 25% of India, which can be described as middle class. This is another more kind of official survey by NSSO, National Sample Survey Organization, and this is important. This is 2009-10 survey, so it's only about urban areas. But if you look at this gives disaggregated data for different groups. Who are India's middle classes? If you look at the top 20% at the last column, where you have these four categories: STs, scheduled tribes; SCs, scheduled castes, who were untouchable communities; OBC is communities that are slightly above the untouchable communities, other backward classes as they're called; others basically then works out to be the upper caste, Hindus largely, but also non-Hindus. So you have 43% of them, but they are overrepresented in the 20% population. Around 65% of them come from this community. If you look at the middle class, again they are overrepresented. In other end, if you look at the bottom 20%, as one would expect, scheduled castes and OBCs are overrepresented. But if you look at this lower middle class, that is the third category, which seems to be very diverse, in the sense that you have more or less every community in proportion to their population. And this is significant for the argument that I am developing. So you have this kind of diversification showing in this data, which is collected at the end of first decade of the 21st century. There are other estimates, for example, McKinsey also has made an estimate, again, these are market-driven estimates, which look at the growing potential of middle class, and it says that at the moment, that was in 2007, only around 7.3% Indians could be described as belonging to the middle class, but they're growing very rapidly. And by 2025, they could be 25% or something like that. 2015, their number could be 250 million, which would be around 20% of the population. And by 2025, their number could be 583 million, which is very, very large as an absolute number for market. So I think let's go back to the qualitative discussion. There are problems with this kind of discourse of middle class, which focuses only on numbers, because being middle class is not only being middle income person. Middle income person could be a shopkeeper, middle income person could be a farmer, middle income person could be a rentier. So you have large categories of people who would come into the middle income category. But when we are talking about middle class as a sociological and historical category, we also think of middle class as a relationship. As a relationship, middle class, as it has grown in different parts of the world, and that's why I was saying in the beginning that middle class is a modern category, it has to have some kind of independence. Only then it can provide a modern kind of society. So is Indian middle class an independent class? Is Indian middle class a non-dependent, non-patriarchal, dependent class? That is kind of a different question. Some people have talked about it, but not in much detail. So what happens in the 90s, you have a kind of paradigm shift in India's developmental policy. You have a kind of India developing with their state is in command, and state is again controlled by people who come from traditionally dominant communities and certain dominant classes. But there is also political democracy, and there are quotas introduced for people who have historically been on the margins of Indian society. So state plays a very active role or important role in laying the foundation of this new middle class. But in the 90s, you have expansion of market. So the discourse of middle class also moves from being a civil servant to being a corporate executive. So that's where the dynamics lie. This is also a time when you see middle class growing in confidence. You know, if you look at the middle class of 80s and 70s, there's a lot of anxiety. By the 90s, somebody like Gurcharandas has said that, you know, they're the people who know what they want and they know how to get it. So there is this new young, not always young, but people who can move around in the world, and they have acquired a new kind of confidence. They also begin to operate globally. Pre-90s middle class is very nationalist, in the sense that for them, India is primary, and India is a country tries to stop influences from outside coming in. Buying somebody which is imported in India used to be such a craze because things were not available. So there were barriers to trade, and people didn't travel much. Those who travel, they would bring some foreign goods home, and that would be the most dear possession. 90s, when India opens up, there is this, you know, new kind of indicator of development where, you know, direct foreign investment becomes a variable through which you measure whether this state is doing well or not. Before that, it's just the opposite. Share market opens up. I mean, until 1990s, we didn't really know what share market was. Right? Suddenly, television channels start showing indexes of share market. And this is something that people like me didn't really understand. We don't understand still. But there's a new kind of language through which nation is being articulated in the 90s. This is also a time when rural begins to decline and virtually disappear from the popular imagination of India. So this is something which is very, very surprising, because as I told you, two-thirds of India in 2001, 72% of land in rural area, even now it is 69%. It's not significantly lesser. But if you talk about the India of 90s, you hardly talk about village. Village is talked about as the place where farmers always commit suicide, where you have deprivation, where you have poverty, ignorance, illiteracy, the kind of things that people used to talk about in the 50s. So how does one interpret this middle class? There are different ways in which it has been talked about. One is the obvious way, that is to celebrate the rise of India. And when you celebrate the rise of India, you basically celebrate the rise of this middle class. There are many people who do that, and that is how it is kind of globally also talked about. There's another discourse which has become popular in the last 4 or 5 years, and that is the discourse of governance. With the rise of middle class, you have a new India which is trying to become, in a sense, modern is the wrong word, but which is structured around good governance. You have anti-corruption movement, you have transparency movement, and you have the new politics of what is called as the armed army. That this country has been controlled for a long time by these power elites who are crooked, who are corrupt, who are bad human beings, and now we common people must take over. And these common people are basically the new middle classes who live in urban areas, who are educated, who know what is good, who know what is right, who know what is wrong, and they are the ones who should come to the streets and they should, in a sense, take over India. Kind of serious critique of Indian middle class or the new middle class, which is obsessed with the governance agenda. And that critique, in a sense, supplements what one would call as the governance discourse. And that would say that this middle class, the book published by Amitabh Bhaviskar and Raka Ray, is called Elite and Every Man or Everyone. And this says that middle class has in a sense begun to represent everyone. And middle class claims to be everyone, even though middle class actually is a class of elite. So middle classness is not really a social category. Middle classness is a discourse. And this is the discourse of hegemony, where you try to claim that you are the ones who can speak for everyone. And this language is not the language of Indianness. Actually, this is the language of exclusion. So they would say, and to some extent there is an element of truth in this, that this new middle class, on the name of governance, what is trying to do is to capture Indian democracy. Indian democracy, which is producing diversity, which is producing difference, which is trying to accommodate all kinds of people, particularly the rise of backward caste elite, political elite. And this middle class, which is urban, which is upper caste, which is Hindu, is in a sense trying to react to that and is trying to capture the state power from them. And therefore, middle class is a hegemonic space. Middle class, on the name of governance, on the name of India, on the name of progress, they're basically trying to represent everyone without being everyone. They're actually a very small category of mostly men, occasionally women, but all upper caste, all urban. They don't talk about rural India, they don't talk about Muslims, they don't talk about Dalits, they don't talk about OBCs, and that's where the real India is. So all those problems, so the middle class is actually the ruling class. See, if the ruling class tries to use the word middle class to make itself as the representative class. There is an element of truth in that. I'll complete in the next 2 minutes. But there are problems with this. If you look at empirically, and if you go back to that table, which I was saying that the significant. Over the last 50, 60 years, India has made progress not only economically, but also significant progress has been made socially. Right? My own study of Dalit middle classes shows that if you look at the rise of Dalit middle class, it happens in the 80s. And in the 1980s, you also have new kind of movements emerging. And where does this Dalit middle class come from? Right? You have the introduction of quotas soon after independence and to some extent before independence also, job quotas, education quotas for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. And you don't find any candidates for top-end jobs. You find candidates for the lower-end jobs, but at the top-end, you don't have educated Dalits who can become civil servants or who can become engineers in the public sector industry. But you do find people at the lower end. So what you find, you look at the data, they are overrepresented at the lowest end of public sector employment. But this lowest end of public sector employment also makes them some kind of a lower middle class because they move to the town. And when they move to the town, they move with their families because government job gives you a pension, gives you a house. And they are very, very keen that their children go to schools. And they're very, very, I mean, that's where Ambedkar was very significant. Educate. Education is revolution. So education is the source of mobility. So they're very, very keen that the children study. And by 80s, you have the second generation of Dalits coming to the picture almost by 70s. And by late 70s, they start joining government jobs at higher level. By 80s, they begin to articulate their own experience of discrimination in the office. And this experience of discrimination in the office then begins to take political shape. And then they begin to articulate themselves through political formations, through social groups. So this middle class, Dalit middle class, is a class which is in absolute size may not be very big, but it's not small either. Look at quotas in elections. Every parliament has 16% Dalit seats, 7% scheduled tribe seats. Every school, government school, has to have quotas for them. Engineering colleges have that. So over a period of time, the number of people who have gone through this experience of being leaders is very, very large. And they are not the ones who can be taken for granted. Right? So their voice has to be heard. So when we talk about hegemony of the Indian middle class, this hegemony has its limitations. This hegemony argument has its problems because middle class identity in India is extremely fractured identity, and middle class speaks in various multiple voices. And over the last 20 years, even though I am also a critique of neoliberal development, but there has also been a grassrooting of Indian democracy. Democracy in India has become much stronger than it used to be 20 years back or 30 years back during the Nehruvian period. The diversity of leadership is much more. The diversity of middle class is much more. So in some areas, Dalits, for example, have become quite influential and quite significant. No political party can ignore them because it's very difficult to control them. And that also applies to rural India, that, you know, this whole discourse of decline of the rural doesn't give any agency to the rural. While the fact is that rural has self-consciously dissociated itself from the rural. The point I'm making is that rural elite has moved to the urban. And because rural elite has stakes in the urban, therefore it doesn't represent the rural any longer. And because the children of all these big farmers, as again I'm speaking from my own empirical study, big farmers and their children don't want to live in the village. And because big farmers have resources, their children study in urban schools, they go to urban colleges, they look for urban jobs. Rich farmers' daughters don't stay in the village. They go to towns, they live in hostels, so that they can find a groom who has an urban employment. And this is really, you know, something very, very significant. So the middle class space continues to be very diverse. Even though it tries to propagate a discourse of hegemony, it is not going to be successful. So you have this Aam Aadmi Party, Anna Hazare movement, which seemed very, very influential 2 years back, and it has already declined. And politically, my own prediction is, it is not going to make much impact. So even though middle class remains significant, the dominant caste or the dominant upper caste voice of middle class is not going to be as powerful as they think it is going to be, or as it used to be until the 1980s.
Thank you very much, Professor Surinder Jodhka. And we will now open up the floor for questions and comments. And this time we have a microphone. So,
from Copenhagen, and I can mention by the way that the voice, even up here, one can hear what you said. I don't know if you can hear.
Yeah, I can hear you. Okay.
I have no objections at all, almost, to what you said, except that you base your whole historical narrative of the development of the middle class in India on what I think may not be what you said. Something which I want to ask you, is that really what you meant? What you said was that when the middle class was created almost 200 years ago, the British did it because they had not enough people in England who could take all those jobs which were being created by the British Raj in India. You are sort of implied by that demographic statement that had the British had more people, each and every Babu in the whole of British India would have been would have been somebody sent out from the UK to India, and so on for the rest of the middle class positions, whatever, lawyers or whatever else was there. Did you really mean this? Is that really your reading of what happened at that time?
No, I'm not a historian. It's actually, that was just one of the, you know, quick explanation I gave. I mean, one knows from a lot of literature that it was because of producing legitimacy, because of local participation, all those things are there. But I'm not really making a historical argument. That's not really where my work is. I was just saying that it did create there, and there are 3 or 4 or 5 or 7 different causes, and obviously there are many more. Right, so I completely agree with you. I was just trying to kind of, already have taken longer time than I should have.
My name is Anjush. I'm a student here. And my question is, you talked about all positive sides of the religion. What are the negative sides of the religion? Are there the curse of India? Because they are going.
It's not very difficult to talk about the negative side. And that's what I said, that this whole hegemony discourse, exclusion discourse, middle class. The point is that That's the concluding point I wanted to make, that middle class has not been researched in the way it should be researched. Right? You have these sweeping statements being made on middle class. What is middle class? When you say negative side, what do we mean by negative side? Yes, middle class consumes a lot, therefore creates environmental problem. Middle class is self-obsessed. I mean, you have this great Indian middle class book by this Verma, or my colleague Dipankar Gupta has written on mistaken modernity. You can keep abusing middle class because we are basically abusing ourselves and we are fond of doing that. That's not the point. The point is historically, how do you understand this process? It's not a question of positive or negative. Unless, I mean, you can't have democracy in India unless you have leaders. And you can't have democracy in India unless you have leaders from diverse categories of population. So the fact that you have Dalit middle class emerging, Dalit middle class does not speak only for themselves. They have the compulsion of speaking for the communities they come from. Right? If you look at the Indian democracy, grammar of Indian democracy, it's wonderful. Right? We were talking about wonder that India is. It actually is wonderful. You know, the way articulate, various people articulate and contest each other's argument. And this is not something which is happening everywhere in the world. The kind of contestation, democratic space in India is very open. And that's something we should recognize. Of course there are many problems, no doubt about that. I mean, there's absolutely no doubt about it. And that is self-criticism, we should do it. But historically, I think there are significant processes where middle class needs to be taken very seriously. But empirically, we have not even been able to frame questions. You have either the statistical discourse or you have this hegemonic discourse which is abusive of the middle class, even though themselves they are middle class. But there is also this whole question of leadership, of diversities. Right? Leadership of diversities is something which has happened in India in the last 20 years. In 1980s, you did not have that. And that's the point I'm trying to make. Yeah. Yes.
Jonathan Spencer, Edinburgh. Thank you very much. Extremely illuminating talk. It's particularly nice to see all those figures and attempts to root it in some kind of evidence, because I think your point about sweeping statements about the middle class without any kind of empirical background said well taken by me. I've been thinking about this from the perspective of Sri Lanka. I was hoping nobody else would hear about it. From the perspective of Sri Lanka, where you have 15, 20 years earlier start with the liberalisation, and so the processes of the growth of the new middle class are much more advanced. And one of the things that's apparent there now is a really strange kind of cultural ambivalence that's emerged, that the people that have benefited most clearly from liberalisation also politically in many ways try to disavow it. So there's a very, very strong anti-liberalisation discourse that blames the war, blames everything on liberalisation. And the people who attach themselves most fiercely to that are precisely these new urban middle class people, who also align themselves with various kinds of new extremist nationalist groups and stuff like that. So I was wondering whether there's any evidence of that kind of ambivalence within the picture in India too, or indeed Bangladesh, Pakistan, or anywhere else.
Well, thank you very much for asking that question, because that's the argument that I was trying to make. That the opposition to neoliberal development is coming from within middle class. The new sections of middle class which are emerging on the periphery of the earlier mainstream middle class. That's why it's very important to understand the link between the Nehruvian period, the nation building period, and the later. That's why I was giving the example of Dalit middle class. How does the Dalit middle class emerge? How does a small middle class among India's scheduled tribe emerge? It's because of the quota systems that government of India introduced in employment and in politics and in education. If you did not have that quota system, you would not have had this kind of diversity. And because of this diversity, middle class becomes a very, very contested space. So this overemphasis on market reforms producing Indian middle class, you would not have had engineers. Simply because there is demand for computer software engineers, you would have Kakinada district in Andhra Pradesh producing thousands and hundreds of thousands of engineers? No. Because already there was an infrastructure set up by India. In 1980s, India was already third or fourth largest human technical manpower, human power country. Right? So you already had these educational institutions which were set up by the Nehruvian India. And that is laying the foundation of the possibility of a new kind of labor force emerging in India, which can then cater to the emerging needs of globalization. And because of that, there are three, four tendencies. One is, I think the point that he was making, very strong right-wing tendency within the middle class, which would not want to have any kind of diversity through reservations, through quotas, through democracy. They want India to become like a Singapore, completely controlled, cleanly governed country, right? And then you also have this some kind of broad anti-liberalization movement, which is just picking up. I think it's still not very strong, but the opposition comes, or the opposition comes from these margins, Dalit middle class. Dalit middle class can't identify with neoliberalization, and my own work shows that actually labor market discrimination has increased because of the informalization of employment. You don't have quotas in private sector, and you have these kind of upper caste ghettos emerging at the upper end of power structure in the corporate sector. So there are many problems with neoliberal development. But that doesn't exhaust the discourse on middle class. I think middle class, you can't understand Indian democracy and deepening of Indian democracy unless you recognize the role of this diverse leadership which has emerged in different communities because of earlier period. Same way, I think if one needs to look at colonial period, one would find many more processes. And there is connection between say, Ambedkar and Dalit movement. And Ambedkar could emerge because Britishers had this policy of hiring Mahars in military. Right? If they did not have that policy, Ambedkar's father wouldn't have had the opportunity to give his children secular education. So there are historical links, and I think that is something which we should remember.
We have one more last question. Professor
Ayajesha
Sivika, please.
Professor Jodhka, excellent presentation. Thank you, and I completely take your point that there has to be greater empirical research, and I believe greater empirical research on the discourse of the middle class. Discourse is a process, independent process in itself.
Yeah.
So how does it fit in with the parallel process of the middle class? But my question to you is that, would you look at it, you know, in the historical perspective of the development of the Indian state itself, which affects the discourse of the middle class? Now, what I mean by this is that if the state is historically authoritarian, which the Indian state is, it's civil authoritarian,
yeah,
then it would impact the behavior of any class. Especially in evolving class. I mean, for example, if you look at, take the example of the Dalit Chief Minister of UP. Now, her behavior was exactly as the traditional power elite that she had replaced. So I would argue that it does take a lot of time before a state matures to a point where the new emerging classes would have a different set of beliefs and behavior than what you have in the traditional elite. A middle class is technically, you know, a new or an emerging elite. So I would argue that the nature of the state has a direct impact. Would you see it in this way?
Yeah, I agree and disagree with you. Disagree is also underlined. This is not actually the case. I mean, my own reading of Indian political elite is very different. I think Indian political elite has become very open, and it has compulsion to be open. It's not easy. State system is, I think, separate from, not exactly separate, but state system is one process and elite formation is another process. If you look at the last 10 years of UPA government, there are some very important and interesting subtle trends. For example, the discourse of minority appeasement has virtually disappeared. Right? If BJP has to talk about coming to power, it has to actually appease Muslims actively. Right? Narendra Modi recently ordered, agreed for death punishment to one of her ministers who has already been... I'm not saying that BJP has become secular, not at all. The point I'm making is that post-Satcher committee, Satcher was a complete failure. But Satcher succeeded in changing the discourse on Muslims in India. Right? The moment Satcher committee introduced the discourse of Muslim community in terms of development and lack of development, Muslims lashed it. Muslims said, this is our frame, this is our problem. And even today you go to interior India anywhere, almost every Muslim talks about such a committee report. Look at this. This is what we are. And you have, the point I'm making is that Indian democracy is opening up spaces. I'm not at all disagreeing on the fact that Indian state continues to be in some sense very authoritarian. But in many ways, political elite have the compulsion to respond to the immediate context. And diversity is significant. I don't agree with you on Mayawati. I would not agree with you on Lalu Yadav. I would not agree with you on these OBC leaders coming to power. They do bring in agenda. They are corrupt. They have all the problems. But they also bring in a new set of elites, new set of kind of people whom they patronize. And that creates new kind of equations. In UP, for example, you go to villages of UP where Mayawati has been influential, there are negotiations happening, caste level negotiations happening in terms of power relations. Somebody was doing research from my neighboring university, Ignu, who was saying that there are villages where Chamars have become a dominant caste because others have either run away or they, because of, you know, traditionally they had some land. So there is a lot of change happening on ground in India at the local level. Local level politics in rural India doesn't work the way it used to work 20 years back. There is discrimination, no doubt about that. I'm not saying that it's not there. But at the local level, you can't work the way you could work even 20 years back. You know, there's a lot of negotiation has to be done. Lot of empowerment is a wrong word, but a lot of accommodation happens.
Yeah. Thank you very much.